Our first speaker that I'd like to introduce, Kevin Wilk. I've known Kevin for a long time, and actually back in the days of, does anyone here remember the Sports Channel? If you didn't pay for your cable, you got the Sports Channel. So I became a New Jersey Nets fan because I didn't have to pay to watch it. So on the Sports Channel in the 1980s, you go home, you turn the TV on at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and what do you see? You see this physical therapist doing all these sports physical therapy videos on the Sports Channel. It was Kevin Wilk. And I said, wow, this guy must be important. And I soon realized he was the most prominent sports physical therapist in the country. So we ran a conference in 1991 in this room, and he was our keynote speaker. And he didn't show up. And we're sitting in this room, and I'm going, and somebody told me, Wilk canceled. And I'm going, he canceled? He says, yeah. He says, the weather's too bad. He says, the weather's too bad? What the? So we went, we had our conference, we went through the whole day. And then at the end of the day, I went outside, and the FDR was flooded. There were cars floating into the East River, and it was the perfect storm. So the day of the perfect storm, which was our trivia question last night, was the day we ran a conference, and his flight was canceled. So it wasn't his fault. I thought he was a pussy that he couldn't come because it was raining. So the guy is usually booked 2 years in advance for his talk. So we said, Kevin, you got to come back and give us the talk you're supposed to give in 1991. I don't think he's treating his ACL patients the same now as he did in 1991. I think he's advanced a little bit. But I mean, nobody knows more about the rehabilitation of ACL patients. So I'd like to invite Kevin up to give a talk. And thanks for coming.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here. It's a pleasure to be with you all. And I think today I looked at the program. The program's excellent. And I'm really sorry I've got to kind of duck out to go somewhere else, unfortunately. But hopefully you'll get some information from my presentation. And what Mal and Tim asked me to talk about is ACL rehab and kind of blending a little bit of the biology behind what we do in rehabilitation. So I'm going to try to do that as best I can. A lot of what I'm going to talk about is proprioception and neuromuscular exercises with a focus on some functional training, though. So hopefully it'll make sense. These are my faculty disclosures, of which none should come into play with this particular presentation. So as I mentioned, today is going to be an outstanding course and some excellent presenters. I've got to kind of ride this wave a little bit. I'm originally from Chicago. I've been in Birmingham for a long time, but I'm still a Chicagoan. I'm from the South Side, so everybody always said, well, you know, you worked with the White Sox. You must be a White Sox fan. You hate the Cubs. No, I love Chicago, so it doesn't really matter to me if the Cubs or the White Sox win. So it's really great. And especially when you see people like this, you know, this is a lady who's 100 years old. This guy's 102, 103. So it's been a long time. They've actually saw the last World Series championship. So it's really outstanding. And if you ever get a chance to go to Wrigley, you should do this. The fans are outstanding. Look at this guy here. There we go. There he is. So pretty impressive. I think his wife was very upset by it for some reason. So it's a pleasure to be here in New York. And unfortunately, I never met Dr. James Nicholas, but Dr. Andrews has told me stories about your dad and what a great man he was, and just really a pioneer. And obviously, Dr. Kane may address this a little bit. He took care of a very famous person in Alabama, Joe Namath, who was a great quarterback at Alabama for the Jets and so forth. So it's really great to be here, and Dr. Andrews can't say enough about Dr. James Nicholas. So these are friends of mine. I've known for a really long time, so when they asked me to come, there's no way I would miss it, even if a perfect storm came about. So there's not a better group that I have more respect for than the group here at Lenox Hill. So thanks so much for allowing me to present. So we're in Birmingham, Dr. Kane and I, and this is where we work. Physical therapy is on the first floor here, physical and occupational therapy. And Dr. Kane's office with Dr. Andrews and Dr. Dugas is right upstairs. And so we have a team approach, which was obviously advocated by James and Stephen Nicholas as well. So it's a pleasure to be here. So ACL rehab, this is a cheetah. This is the fastest animal in the world. Did you know that, Mel? And it's closing in on its prey. And there's one of my ACL patients. who did the program that I'm going to advocate, and so you should really probably take notes. The irony is insurance didn't pay for all the visits. It's really unbelievable, even though could beat Usain Bolt in a race. So I think if you look at these young ladies, they don't look like they're ready to go back to volleyball or jumping sport. If you look at how they land in this scenario on your left, they're in trouble. But with jump training and sport metrics is what they did, Dr. Noyes' program, look at where they're landing. Obviously, she needs a little bit more help, but she's in good position. Males can have the same phenomenon. I'm sure you see this in younger people, high school age athletes, especially tall individuals. They land and they have what's called a valgus collapse. So we're going to talk about that a little bit. We're going to talk about injuries, a little bit on biology, but a lot on proprioception. So here's some numbers for you. There's about 200,000 ACL injuries in the United States annually. This is a number you can pretty much take to the bank. This is insurance generated as far as reimbursement. There's 148,700 plus ACL reconstructions annually. That represents over the last 20 years about a 60% increase in ACL surgeries. This is the ACL here, and obviously it's made up of numerous thousands and thousands of bundles. And it has a semi-circular type of origin on the femoral side. So there's constant tension on the ACL as a person goes through an arc of motion. And that's part of the challenge that orthopedic surgeons have, is reproducing the ACL, not just reproducing one bundle. About 70% of the ACL injuries are non-contact. That's Rebecca Lobo landing from a jump, gets bumped, her knee goes into a valgus collapse, and she had a series of ACL injuries. The problem we're experiencing with some of our ACL patients is we like to think they all do well, and well is a relative thing, but when you score them out, they may not be doing quite as well as we once thought. So if you objectively test them and bring them back at a year, 2 years, and you do a stringent evaluation like the International Knee Documentation scoring, you may find that about, you know, two-thirds of your patients are scoring in the 60, 70 points out of 100. Personally, I like to see them all 80, 90 points out of 100. The problem is there's concomitant injuries. So you injure your meniscus, that decreases your probability or your likelihood of functioning at a high level. It also depends on what you're going back to. This is a study by Carey, American Journal of Sports Medicine 06, looking at NFL players, running backs and wide receivers. 80% returned to play. That's fantastic. But performance was decreased by a third. So if you're at that level and you can't stay at that level of 80, 90% of what you were before, 66% is going to probably get you on the sideline or off the team. So NFL would stand for not for long if you're performing at 66%. What about in the NBA? 78% return to play, but 44% experienced decreased stats, playing time as well as performance. This is a bad injury. Watch the guy dribbling the ball, he lands. Big injury. Just want to make sure you're awake. So this is Sean Livingston, who played in Brooklyn a couple years ago. Some of you, if you're a basketball fan, know the name. So he dislocates his knee. ACL, PCL, dislocated patella, MCL, medial meniscus, lateral meniscus, big femoral bone bruise. But the good news is on the lateral side, everything was good. And that's what Dr. Andrews told him. Sean, I got good news for you. Your LCL was fine. Everything else, we're going to have to either repair or do a reconstruction. Now, the good part about this was 06-07 season, and there he is being corded off. Knee dislocations are obviously very, 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 very serious. And there's Sean last year and this year. So some 9 years later, he's actually performing at a higher level. So I like to say, hey, we're great, but we got lucky. Everything matched up. The surgery was perfect. Dedicated individual, worked very, very hard. Pro athlete. We don't have to count visits. We got lucky. We got lucky as well as maybe good. Watch this young lady here. We didn't get quite so lucky with her. Played up the street, up in UConn, freshman year, first ACL of five. Five ACL injuries during college. She's now assistant coach at UConn. Watch this high school kid here. Probably one of the tougher patients I ever dealt with. She makes a lateral move, and she tears her left ACL. The amazing thing is she actually completes the pass. The other amazing thing is it's the third quarter, and she winds up playing the rest of the game. She has multiple giving way episodes. And sometimes you get that with patients. They tear their ACL, especially kids. They don't know. Felt a pop in my knee. Didn't feel that bad. You know, kind of a little stiff. Got back out there. Kind of shifted on me. And I stayed in the game. Here she is right here. He's kind of bending over. My knee doesn't feel good right now. You get the ball. I don't want it. Now watch when she runs down court. Here she is right here. She's going to do a lateral movement. See, she's limping a little bit. Right there, her knee gives way. But that's not going to stop her. She stays in the game. Here's a young lady cheerleading tryouts. Bilateral ACLs. And she didn't make the squad. Sometimes athleticism is the issue. Tears her ACL. So we looked at our NFL players returning back, and about 63% made it back to sports. Now, here's a study that a lot of people cite. This is by Claire Arden out of Australia. She looked at a meta-analysis of 48 studies, almost 6,000 ACLs. 82% returned back to some form of sport. The problem is the level of sport. There's three levels to sports. Level one sports, cutting and pivoting, is really the challenge. Going back to competitive sports, 44% made it back. So that's pretty low. What was the number one reason people didn't make it back in that meta-analysis? Fear of re-injury. So, and you see this with kids. Sometimes they blow out their knee, or maybe even it's a person who's kind of middle-aged, snow skiing injury. The first thing I ask them is, are you going to ski again? And they're freaked out. And it's like, well, you know, it's like a horse that throws you. Maybe you got to get back on there. Well, I don't know. We'll talk about that later. I just want to get my knee right. 13% have problems with structure. If your knee doesn't feel right because you have shifting or giving way, there's a problem with your graft, you're probably going to have a fear of re-injury. And that's been shown by a couple studies. And then obviously people just occasionally graduate. They want to quit their team or whatever, or they're just at the end of their career. Fear of re-injury is called kinesiophobia. And this is a paper that came out in the spine literature. And the idea was that somebody would hurt their back, have back surgery, and they didn't want to go back to work because they were fearful of re-injuring their back. Terry Shimoleski, who did a fellowship with me several years ago when she was at Delaware working on her PhD and at the University of Florida teaching in the PT program, applied that principle to ACL patients and found a large percentage of people after ACLs, recreational athletes, have this fear of re-injury. Now, I'm not quite sure you see this with high-level competitive athletes, because they're used to injuries, they're used to trying to get back, it's their livelihood, highly motivated. But I think this is especially critical in that recreational athlete or that young person. But if you play for the New York Jets, you're probably not that fearful about a second injury, or at the University of Alabama. If anything, we're trying to slow you down many times, try to pull back on the reins. So Terry's done some nice work. We've written a couple editorials on this saying that we can do better in our rehab, that we have to get it right, because there's problems if we don't. So let's talk about that a little bit. Let's talk about building limb confidence in rehabilitation. So perturbation training, I think most people who are PTs and ATCs in this room know that term. Perturbation training is a postural disturbance. And we introduced that in 99, and then Kelly Fitzgerald from the University of Pittsburgh with Lynn Snyder-Mackler at Delaware has done some nice research in this particular area. And they showed with ACL deficient knees, if you do perturbation training, these individuals actually make it back to a higher percentage and a higher rate than if you just did a standard rehab program. And these were ACL deficient knees. And these were called COPRs, which is a very controversial subject, by the way. So what's perturbation training? Well, this young lady's doing a rocker board squat, ACL reconstruction, and I'm going to come up behind her. Kind of sneak up, there we go, and tap the platform. And I throw her balance off. And what I'm looking for is how fast can she right the board? I don't mind if the board moves. What I'm interested in is can she correct? Can she control it? Then we may go to a single leg where she's in this co-activated position. You notice her knee is about 30 degrees, the 45 degrees, hips around 30 degrees. That gives you a lot of co-activation between hamstrings and quads, also your glutes. Perturbation training, we start early. This is one of Dr. Kane's patients. Alabama player, now plays in San Francisco, NFL safety, ACL reconstruction, his steri strips are still on. And you notice I'm tapping his hips. I also tap on his head, his stomach, his legs, because that's what a perturbation is. In sports, you're not going to just get tapped on the on your feet or whatever. You saw Rebecca Lobo, she got hit on her hips as well as her her shoulders. So here's another DB. He's got a lot of swag. DBs usually have swag. Safeties are mean. And so here he is on the BOSU ball, and he's just kind of riding it. It's almost like surfing. You know, that's my analogy with the BOSU ball. It's okay that it moves, but he rides the waves, so to speak. It's controlled. It's not a sudden jerking type of motion. His knee isn't collapsing in. He's controlling the BOSU. So again, we call this the balance position, and again, this is critical to co-activation of your quads and hamstrings. What he wants to do, what a typical patient wants to do, is extend. They want to be straight on that. And by being straight, you unload your quads and hamstrings. So now we're on foam. For those of you who use foam, you know this. You have ankle strategies. So we're trying to stabilize the knee from below and above. Really critical concept. Use a ton of foam. Now he's on the BOSU. One of our trainers are tapping it as we throw a ball to him to take his mind off his knee. And again, this is a tough exercise, obviously. Here's a basketball player. We're using two balls side by side. Just filmed this off my phone, so it's not great. But that's tough from a tracking mechanism. Now he goes single leg, and you can see his flex position. Really difficult when two balls are coming toward you. As he releases one, the other one's coming. So he's got to, you know, think about the ball so he doesn't get hit. But more importantly, his knee, subconsciously, he's able to stabilize. Here's one of the RDLs, right? Romanian deadlifts or single leg deadlifts. And what we're doing is what we call a star drill. So he catches the ball, he touches it, touches the cone. But again, two balls. So again, this represents obviously a progression. The other thing he was on was foam that I failed to mention. Tough exercise. Sometimes we get a little carried away. So now we've got a band around his leg. It's called lassoing. We're pulling him into valgus, right? So he has to control the valgus moment. We've got a pissed off therapist behind tapping the platform because this guy came 2 hours late. And this guy is moving his hands in front of this gentleman's eyes. He's an NBA basketball player. And we feel as though if they can do something like that, probably running down court should be pretty anticlimactic. So this is not Batman, so don't get concerned. He thinks he's Batman occasionally. So he's doing some lateral slides. These are TheraBand CLX bands. And so we're trying to activate his lateral hip, which is critical to controlling valgus collapse. The arms come into play only because we want to add more resistance to the hips. And I'll show you a progression with this. Another concept that I'd like to talk to you about is change of planes. Sports is all about changing planes. So it's interesting to me when you watch a football practice and they do tires and things of that nature, they go straight plane. Why do chops all the way down? That's not how it really works. It's almost like a warm-up drill. So what we're asking him to do on verbal commands is I'll say switch. And he's got to change direction or change the drill. So we give them two movements and we tell them reverse means go in the opposite direction, forward means go forward. We have to be very simple at our clinic. But you can see he's got fast feet. There's another one of Dr. Kane's patients, ACL reconstruction. And by his own admission, he says he's not ready, which is important. I ask people all the time, 0 to 100, how's your knee feeling? What percentage? Their perception is almost exactly where they're at. Trust me on this, especially in an athlete. So some lateral drills. Here he's doing some lateral drills. TheraBand around his ankles, lot of hip. The biggest area that my ACL patients say if they feel any soreness is in their glutes. And I'm fine with that. They'll come in and say, man, my glutes are on fire this morning. So I guess we're not doing hip today. No, we're doing hip today. It's like, really? I'm so sore though. Yeah, well, yeah, you'll work the soreness out. How's your knee? Oh, I don't even know about my knee. And that's what we want. And obviously we're trying to control swelling, and obviously this would be a progression. So this is, let me go to the next one so you can hear the sound. So these are reactive lateral slides. This is all glute med, by the way. So I'm telling him the direction. He had a bad pass there. This is just a recreational athlete. And some of these individuals have a problem with left-right, as well as I do for some reason. Now, this is more of what these CLX bands we use. So this is a recreational basketball player, ACL. we crisscross the bands, and a lot of times a person like this will say, I feel it more on my shoulders than a lot of times my hips. So watch the bands. Silver's probably too much for her. That's one of the highest grade resistance. She probably needs blue or black. But you notice when I was throwing the ball to her, did you see what she was doing? She was stopping. I don't like that. She's thinking about it too much. Those other people, those guys, they were catching it and moving. So we've got to work on it. For you individuals that like the NBA, like what they were doing with Curry last year after his ankle sprains, these are the lateral slides with stabilization. So I ask her, I say, right, stabilize. And I try to push her. I try to push her off balance. And she's got to stick to the ground, almost like a gymnast landing from a jump. This doesn't seem like much, but trust me, with your ACL patients at about 6 to 8 weeks, you'll get their attention. Here's a young lady, speaking of gymnasts, so she's got blue bands, she's like an eighth grade or freshman in high school. Very good gymnast, state champ, fractured foot. So now, if we watch closely, I'll try to stop this at the right time. Do you see what I'm doing? I'm pushing her actually in the air. So this represents a little bit of progression for me. I mean, this gets a little edgy, and obviously pick your patients. But she's a gymnast. I would do this with a basketball player as well at the appropriate time frame. So when she's airborne, I tap her. I try to throw her off balance. That's what happened to Lobo. She went up, she came down, she got hit, and she's off balance. So now she's got CLX bands. You see what happened? She lost her balance. This is a state champion. The thing keeps pulling out for some reason. So what I might do is ask her to do a slide, and now jump and land. And she sticks it. It's a tough drill. Now she can do this at home. She can do it with her coaches before gymnastics practice as well. And we do this with female basketball players and volleyball players all the time. We give them a CLX band, we tell them to get in front of the mirror and work on your jumps and land. Do not let your knees go in. Land flexed, land soft. Land with hip flexion. Watch where your trunk is. Aren't those the components of tearing an ACL? This is what unfortunately happens. Alabama soccer goalkeeper tears her right ACL, comes back, plays 2 years, now coaching high school, tears her other one, coaching kids up. So a lot of times your other knee is very vulnerable for a second ACL. So here's a study that just came out, British Journal of Sports Medicine, by Lynn Snyder-Mackler and Lars Engerbertsen out of Oslo, Norway. 30% of the patients in a combined group that went back to level sports sustained a second injury after ACL reconstruction. If you go back to a lower sport, lower percentage. So you're 4 times more likely to have a second ACL if you're going back to basketball, volleyball, football, those types, skiing. If you delay the return to sports, up to 9 months, the return that's delayed, you have a lower rate of injury. The other thing that's interesting is more symmetrical quad strength improves your outcome, reduces your re-injury rate, but it also gives you a higher knee score. Almost every ACL follow-up study has shown that. I would ask you to explain why. If we're talking hamstrings to stabilize your knee, your hip, why are quads so important? Something to think about in your rehabilitation. We see it all the time. We wrote a paper on this back in the 90s. Every study has shown this to date. If you have strong quads, you do well. If you have weak quads, you do poorly. Mark Paterno from Ohio State did a study looking at ACL, 15 times greater rate of re-injuring your ACL if you went back to level one sports the first year. If you wait for the second year, it drops nearly in half. Now these are recreational athletes. Where are you most susceptible? Your opposite knee. And you probably see this in rehab all the time. Those individuals that are standing on one leg and we're doing some of these pretty radical drills, a lot of times we'll say stand on your uninvolved side, right? Your good leg, which you should avoid that term, by the way, in my opinion. There is no good leg or bad leg. Your good leg is the leg you just spent $20,000 on, by the way, for your new ACL and rehab. So your good leg is the money leg right now. Could have got a hell of a car. So realize you're most susceptible for that opposite knee. So they need to be doing things for the opposite side. What about pre-op? Pre-op is critical. Another paper just came out about a month ago, American Journal of Sports Medicine. This is from the University of Delaware. If you extend your pre-op, rehabilitation, which is very controversial again. I get it because you're using up visits, but you extend it longer than the 3 weeks, which is sometimes the magic number, to calm the knee down, get your range back. Your outcomes at 2 years are about 15% higher. The problem is controlling their knee so they don't sustain a second injury, injure more meniscus. But if you extend it 3 weeks and beyond, these individuals did better. And again, I think you have to be cautious with this. This could be potentially a problem. Well, how do you know when somebody's ready? Well, here's your guy here in New York, and I wish him luck. Chicago win and all that. Or this guy here, Adrian Peterson. Well, they got trainers and therapists and doctors looking at them daily. This is the issue, is a high school soccer player who's going to be out of visits before she's ready to play. And the physician is going to have to figure it out on a recheck, examining the knee if they're ready to play. Or this guy who's going to snowplow his way into ACL OR again, right? Who invented snowplowing? Is this guy ready to play? He was at the NFL Combine. He's a Heisman Trophy winner, landing from a jump. Doesn't look very good, does he? Looks like you need some training. This is a study by Tim Hewitt that documented there is no association from your ACL reconstruction to return to sports based on time. Time is a bad basis. It's all about neuromuscular control. Some individuals, it's going to be 6 months and they're ready to go and they look perfect. Some may be 7, some may be 9. So objective testing is critical before you go back to something like that. Or something like this. Or something like that. This is one of Dr. Kane's patients. It's a special surgery. Just don't want anybody drifting off on me. Mel.
Still here.
You're still here? It was painful, wasn't it? So who's most susceptible for ACLs or a second ACL? Females. Females in high school. 15 to 16 years of age. Males are more like 19 to 20, by the way. So watch this girl here. College basketball player. Lands, watch your knee, big injury. Here's one of my patients, high school kid, year before, tore his left ACL, first game back, third play. Watch when he makes his cut. The left knee has a brace on, right knee is the one he's gonna injure, unfortunately. Runs toward the line, boom, right there, he tore his ACL. He knew it. He got up, actually. Walked to the sideline. Hey, doc, I tore my ACL again. And we're like, no, you didn't. We were in denial, not him, unfortunately. He went on and played at Auburn, backup quarterback. Watch this young lady here, volleyball player. This is what you see in volleyball a lot. Is everything okay? You're making me nervous. Right there is when she lands. Look at where her trunk is. See where she lands? Her trunk is way laterally displaced. So one more time, try that one more time, sorry. And this is a very good high school volleyball player. Right there. So what happens with the set, she goes to do a kill shot, she lands, she's laterally displaced, her knee is in full extension, she lands on the medial side of her foot, I know it's hard to see, and she has a valgus collapse. So that's a tough scenario, and we call that, again, a valgus collapse that happens from the ground up, but it also happens from the top down, right? Depends on where your trunk is. And a lot of times, young females have a problem with where their trunk is. So proprioception is critical. Dr. Leppard at the University of Pittsburgh has done extensive research on this. Within 24 hours after your ACL injury, your proprioception is decreasing. People like to walk around with what's called a quadriceps avoidance gait. So they inhibit their quads, they walk around with a facilitated hamstring contraction. That's another reason why, again, quads are down and it's hard to get them back. This is a study we did in 04 where we looked at individuals, high school, college, recreational athletes, and individuals that tore their ACL. If you look at their opposite knee, for 8 weeks, their opposite knee's proprioception is actually decreasing. So we believe when you injure one side, you actually have a bilateral injury. And that's documented in the literature. Dr. Voitis at the University of Michigan documented that as well with elite athletes, female athletes, that for 2 to 3 months, your opposite knee is deteriorating. So when we do our tests, our Biodex tests, our isokinetic tests, our single leg hop tests at 4 months or 6 months, and you're comparing it to the good leg, you're really comparing it to a compromised leg. That's why so many pro teams now try to get baseline data when you're uninjured. So when you get injured, we have a baseline data. And that'd be fantastic if we had it for everyone. What about quad strength? Terry Shimoleski again at Delaware, Hart from the University of Virginia, looked at what happens to your opposite quad over time. It deteriorates. So I'm not saying you have to rehab both sides, but you better do some things for those that opposite knee because it's becoming vulnerable for a re-injury. Bone bruises. Used to be said about 70-80% of all ACLs have a bone bruise. Hollis Potter here in New York documented that 100% of ACL injuries have a bone bruise. You just need to have a strong enough MRI to document it. And the real problem, the reason I bring this up is, if you look at deterioration of the articular cartilage, 50 times more likely to have deterioration 7 to 11 years after your ACL. 50 times more likely. Now, does that mean everybody's going to have that? No. Sean Livingston didn't. I can name more names, but again, it sets up a cascade that we in rehab have to appreciate. We have to respect. Maybe early running, early jumping isn't the best thing. Maybe you need to stage that when the knee is not reactive anymore. How do you determine that? Maybe pain, maybe swelling, maybe how irritable the knee is, what the patient is telling you. You know, again, if you're taking care of the Jets or somebody like that, maybe an individual may get a second MRI or something down the line to see when the bone bruise resolves. So let me show you some more exercise here in the last 15 minutes or so. So here's a basketball player, torn ACL, steroid strip still on, and I'm just ranging his knee. No big deal. Very exciting, right? This is what you got up at 6 o'clock in the morning for, right? Somebody ranging a knee. But what we try to do is what's called passive-active reposition sense. So I say to Kojo, okay, just relax, man. You know, everything okay? Can I get you a latte? Non-fat? No, I'm good. Okay, water? Spring water? No, I'm good. Okay, close your eyes. I'm going to bring your leg up. That was a position. Now I ask him to reposition that leg, that knee flexion angle, at that same angle I put it at. And that way he's engaged in that range of motion. Does that make sense? I do it with all my ACL patients. Now, a young person like this, not going to have a problem. Pro athlete, a recreational person, that's a different scenario. Total knees, they're all over the place. The older the patient, the worse the proprioception. The more skilled athlete, the better. Leppart has written probably a dozen papers on that. This is a very expensive force platform. This is called the Neurocom, and he's just getting used to putting weight on both extremities. We start this about 5 days post-op. So we want you to be 50-50. Here's what's called a balance trainer. It's out of New Jersey. It has these little plates to it, and we look at weight distribution. Why? Because individuals get used to unloading, right? They shift their weight away. You see it all the time. You see it like this. It's a high school kid, tore his ACL, left side, and that's how he does his little mini squats at 5 days post-op. And we tell him, no, shift to the other side. And what he does, he looks like a snake, right? They kind of serpentine to the side. Biodex makes a weight distribution device as well. The newer devices now are motion capture, right? This is something new at our clinic, kind of excited to play with. So this is from the Woodway people. And what it does is it calibrates, right? It digitizes you. So now when I'm standing, I can punch in any joint and it will give me the angles. It also tells me how much weight I'm putting right to left, anterior versus posterior, am I swaying? It captures a lot of information. And we can do static movements as well as dynamic movements. We can do our functional movement screens on this. It's pricey, without a doubt, but a lot of individuals are going to motion capture devices. Bone bruises, you know, for you to go fast, a lot of times with athletes, I want to get back, I want to play. They don't have a fear of re-injury, they have a fear they're going to miss out, right? And I usually tell them the first week sets the stage. I don't care if you're in the NBA, NFL, or you're a recreational athlete. Your first week sets the stage. We have to do certain things the first week, and we've learned this the hard way. If you're overly aggressive in that first week, the knee in a lot of individuals is going to swell like mad. They're going to struggle with extension. They're going to struggle getting swelling out of their knee later on. So if anything, I would recommend go slow the first week, concentrate on extension, get their patella moving, especially with a patellar tendon graft, get swelling down, activate their quads, and easy flexion. More flexion is not good the first week, in my opinion. I want you to hit a milestone. I don't want you to be at 30, but I don't want you at 110. Sometimes people think, oh, you know, I got 115 the first week, that's great. I'd rather have less flexion and less swelling. So hopefully that makes sense. So there are speed limits to this, if you will, and there are milestones. So for me, I mean, obviously there's a lot of different commercial devices out there now. A lot of times, you know, we just use ice and HIVOLT. So let's go through a few more things here as far as, obviously, the surgeons. You got an expert, or actually multiple experts in the room here, Dr. Nicholas, Dr. Kane, Dr. Bedford, and they all have their preferences as far as graft. At our center, it's patellar tendon grafts. Patellar tendon grafts aren't necessarily the strongest graft, but it's bone-to-bone fixation, and that's what we like. So we can get you moving, get you going, and there's been numerous papers looking at graft strength. And a lot has to do with the size of the graft, obviously. Allografts. A lot of therapists deal with allografts. When I lecture at meetings, I say, what do you think of allografts? I'm always very cautious on what I think about allografts because I've been trained by somebody who doesn't exactly like allografts for young athletes. Dr. Andrews is very anti-allografts. So it would be interesting to hear what the physicians in the group are. There's good points and bad points to allografts. The problem with allografts, and a study was done not too far from here from West Point, is allografts in younger people have a higher failure rate. Period. Now, obviously, it depends on the allograft is prepared, but this is from West Point. All the cadets coming in, they previously had surgery when they were in high school, and they looked at failure rates, and the allografts had a 7 times, almost 8 times higher failure rate. It's actually made individuals from the Moon Group have a consensus statement that you should be cautious putting allografts in younger people. They're easier to rehab, trust me. When I worked in Chicago for 4 or 5 years, that's all I saw were allografts. Steady diet of allografts back in the 80s. That's all I treated were allografts. They're easy to rehab. That's why people like them patient-wise. The problem is failures. Double bundle and things of that nature we won't get into. The other issue that I just want the rehab people to respect is when the patient's probably starting to feel the best is when the graft's at its weakest point. And I think everybody knows that, but that needs to be encouraged with patients, especially young people. At 8 weeks, 10 weeks, when they're feeling great, that's biomechanically, that's when your graft is at its weakest point, according to animal studies and extrapolated information and so forth. There also is a concept called ligamentization. Put a tendon in the joint, it becomes a ligament. That takes 12 to 18 months. There's this ligamentization process that takes time. It goes through revascularization, graft maturation, and so forth. Other things for therapists, a lot of times meniscal repairs are done concomitantly. In our hands, you know, the biggest thing is communication. All meniscus repairs are not the same. If it's a peripheral tear with a couple sutures, probably no big deal. If it's a big complex tear, you know, red on white, some people even repair white on white, Dr. Noyes will repair white on white, that needs to be conveyed to the therapist, that's a different rehabilitation program. So for us, there are precautions with meniscus repairs. So we don't like a lot of deep squatting in those individuals. We don't like a lot of active knee flexion beyond 90, and we don't want to do heavy resisted hamstrings for a good 2 months with our meniscus repairs. But the rest for range of motion is the same. No difference. We even weight bear our meniscus repairs, and I know Dr. Nicholas and I have had this conversation years ago at CSM where I even said, you know, the majority of doctors don't weight bear meniscus repairs. And I have this argument with Andrews all the time. He goes, of course they do. And I'm like, of course they don't. I'm telling you, on weekends, 80% of the therapists say they can't weight bear a meniscus repair for 8 weeks, 10 weeks. He's like, no way. Well, it depends on how you weight bear. If you lock their knee in full extension and it's a peripheral tear, who cares? As long as they stay locked, it has compression. The hoop barrel system is enforced. There should be no problem with that. The real issue for me is the articular cartilage. So if a physician does a microfracture or some type of surgical procedure with the ACL, I think that lends itself to a high complexity. That's a slower rehabilitation program. And then injuries like this. This is a bad problem. This is an Olympian long jumper dislocated knee. Made it back. made it back to the Olympics. That's great. But LCL, posterior lateral corner, pulled his IT band off, ACL, PCL. Bad injury. Thank God, no neurovascular. So he's common in injuries years ago. It used to be incisions like this, and thank goodness they've gotten smaller. So let's talk a little bit in this last 10 minutes, kind of staging and what are the priorities. I think the pre-op is critical. Obviously, we can get away with that with pro athletes, but unfortunately, your regular patient who has 12 visits, you know, pre-op is on their own. You educate them, and hopefully they're compliant. But as a therapist and as an athletic trainer in the room, you need to tell patients how critical it is to do their pre-op. And for me, I put them in a brace. I put them in a drop lock brace because I'm trying to protect your meniscus until you have your ACL reconstruction. And I've had numerous kids who walk around and get aggressive, have torn their meniscus more. And then the second most important phase is that first week, as I mentioned before. This is Sean. This is the guy who showed you the video. You can see everything was done all at once, 13 days post-op. Dr. Andrews did everything, no staging. Not a big fan of staging. And what that means is I've got to have a conversation with this gentleman and say, we got to be spot on. You got a high rate of getting stiff. You got a high rate of not making it back. You can't disappear. We're right on our program. You got to do exactly what we say unless you're not going to make it back. This is a eye-to-eye conversation. This is coaching 101. This is serious stuff if you ever want to play again. If you don't, yeah, well, whatever then. But if you want to have a healthy knee, have your knee straight, not have arthritic changes, you got to do exactly what the physician and the therapist have said. So what are the most important concepts? So let's go through these really quick. Preparing the person for surgery. A lot of times a pre-op is mentally getting them ready, making them understand this is a big process. ACL, you know, slam dunk, but hey, first couple days are no pleasure cruise. Second is full passive knee extension. Now this is relative, how much extension is acceptable. Well, if Dr. Shelbourne was here, he'd say whatever's on the opposite side. We've always had this little disagreement. For us, we like a little bit of hyperextension. So if you had 15 degrees of hyperextension on their uninvolved side, non-ACL side, we would go for about 5-7 degrees and let the rest happen over time. And that's, I think, is the best approach. Otherwise, obviously, we wouldn't be doing that. Philosophically, Dr. Kane, Dr. Andrews, and Dr. Dugas, we're all in sync. And again, I can't advocate this more. You talking with your primary referral source and ask them, how much extension do you want post-op? Because some are going to say, go all the way, and some are going to say, I don't want any, I want zero. So if you're saying one thing and the doctor's saying another, that's not a good team approach. Also, extension boards, like you see here. So this is called the extensionator. This is called the extensionator, and there's a lot of these available. So if somebody's struggling, obviously you need to maybe go to other means. Hanging weight. The best is supine. I'm not a big prone hanging weight person. I don't think it works. The hip just goes into a flex position. And the idea is that it's low load, long duration. So the idea is they're in that position for 10-15 minutes at a time. Another big tidbit that you probably all realize in this room, but I can't advocate, mention it enough. If you have an individual who is developing a flexion contracture, you've got to get the patella moving. The patella is the key to extension, especially with a patellar tendon graft. So if they're lacking 5-7 degrees, which doesn't seem like a big deal from full extension, but is, because they're developing scar in the front of their knee, you've got to mobilize the patella superiorly. It's got to move at least 10 to 12 millimeters. If they do not have superior migration of their patella, you can press down all you want forever. It's not going straight. And you see this with arthrofibrotic knees. The knee's hot, they're not very swollen, patella's not moving. The key to the knee is the patella. You want to calm the knee down. Obviously, icing. Working the patella, talking them to not being super aggressive. Gradually working on flexion. Another little tidbit, if you want to decrease the probability of anterior knee pain, three components are critical. Your extension, patellar mobility, and heel to glute flexibility. I don't care if they've never had it in their life. At 12 weeks post-op and beyond, their heel has to touch their butt. Bunch of studies from Denmark, bunch of studies from Sweden have shown in anyone, even people without surgery, lack of knee flexion is one of the highest correlations for developing anterior knee pain, patellar tendonitis, as well as patellofemoral complaints. So even in this big lineman who says, I've never been able to touch or on my opposite side, I say, good, I'm glad you can't touch on your opposite side because now we're going to work on that. Patellar mobilization, critical. Individualize the program. Communication with the physician is vital. I'm very, very fortunate to work where I work because the physicians are right upstairs. We have constant communication. So I'm really, really fortunate in that regard. The need for quads. Again, I'm all about hips. I'm all about glutes. I'm all about posterior chain, trust me. But quads, you got to get it back because that's going to correlate to function. So you might be getting a mixed message. Work the hip, get their hamstring strong, control their foot, but also, by the way, get their quads back. And so in your handouts, based on EMG data, these are the best exercises for your quads. Knee extension, I can't remember the last time I gave somebody a leg extension exercise for an ACL. I usually try to avoid that because I'm just not a big open chain fan. A couple last things to mention, hip control. We talked about this, so this young lady here with a front step down, what am I looking at after her ACL? I'm looking at, does her knee go in, right? Where's her trunk? Does she shift her weight over? If she has pain, she's gonna shift to the side she's weight bearing on. She's not gonna shift away. The problem with shifting to the weight bearing side is that's gonna add to more valgus collapse. So you gotta teach them to work their core. Core is critical for ACL. Tim Hewitt did a study on that in female jumping athletes. Get your core strong, you do better in your ACL rehab. Now, one thing is a step down. Another issue is when you're jumping. So when she jumps, what am I looking at? Where are her knees? Where are her knees in relationship to her toes? Where's her hip flexion angle? Does she land or does she land? I want to land soft, like a feather. And obviously, depending, it's a gymnast, we're going to take her up to a pretty high level. Noise has shown, Dr. Noise has shown, if your knees go in more than 10% of the width of your pelvis, you have a higher rate of ACL re-injury. We talked about the star drill before. Watch my gymnast here. I got like a couple minutes left here. I want to show you a couple quick video clips on a couple radical exercises. Not that the other ones weren't kind of radical. So she's doing RDLs. Gymnasts should have the best RDLs in the world. Their glutes should be the best. To me, they have the best posterior chain in the world of any athlete as a gymnast. But what I'm going to do with her is because she's got to get on the balance beam. So I'm going to put her on a balance beam, which we use a ton of, even in football players. We put football players on balance beams, put baseball players on balance beams, rehabbing their shoulder. So now she's on the balance beam doing a RDL, Romanian deadlift, or a single leg deadlift. I just hold that because those are immobile, they tend to slide. So that's a 4-inch beam, which she's right at home on. Football player gets a little uptight, especially big lineman. Now I've got TheraBand around her distal thigh, pulling into valgus. So she's got to fire her hip. And then what I'll do, if you look closely, I'm actually pulling and relaxing the band. You see that? I'm creating a perturbation. I'm not pulling as hard as we did before because she's on the beam. This is tough. Her mom came to me afterwards and said, you know, when she won state, she had her best routine on the beam. Thanks. I was like, I didn't do it. She did it. But they equated her best beam routine from doing all this goofy stuff. They were like, holy mackerel, you do a lot of goofy stuff. I'm like, yeah, the goofy stuff is the fun stuff. The goofy stuff is taken to the next level. So let me show you one thing for hamstrings here, and then we'll wrap this up. So I love bridging. One of the things that you probably notice with kids is your high school athletes, even your best high school athlete you're dealing with, they have poor hips. They can't bridge. Basketball players are horrible at every level. Professionally, they're horrible. They can't bridge to save their life. So now he's doing some hamstring curls, stability ball, good bridge. That's that safety you saw before. And I'm just guiding the ball a little bit. And I don't know, I'm getting an arm workout. I don't know what I'm doing there. So now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna tell him, I'm gonna pull hard and you slow the ball down. So now we're getting concentric but eccentric. If they wear the Nike Free shoes, you know, those little slipper gym shoes, I'll pull their freaking shoes right off. I pull so hard, seriously. I'm like, you better lace those suckers up or not come with those shoes again because I got a thing against those Nike Frees anyway. There's no support at all. So now we take a piece of TheraBand, I like TheraBand, put it around his ankle. Look at his face, by the way. This is an NFL safety, folks, who loves lifting weights. He never met a mirror he didn't like. We're going to get a little bit crazier. And I know Tim Tyler, the next exercise, he loves the eccentric hamstrings. And Tim has done a lot of work in that area from hamstring strains and so forth. But you can see this guy is really focused on this. A few years ago, here's the eccentric or Norwegian hamstrings. And again, as I mentioned, Tim has talked about this quite a bit, as well as Mel, trying to prevent recurrence of hamstring strain. And you can do this on a Biodex eccentrically as well. I like doing it this way. So what my trainer's doing is he's holding his ankles, obviously. What I'm going to do is I'm going to come in and I'm going to push him to the ground in a second. So I'm going to overload the eccentrics, because I got to try to get even with this guy. So now, I just don't push him. I try to lead him all the way. Does that make sense? So this is heavy eccentric contraction. This is a really tough exercise, folks. This is not for the weak at heart. Now, one little tidbit, and I'll wrap this up. When you're doing this, not necessarily the pushing, but the eccentric hamstrings, you can put a stability ball here. So in other words, a stability ball will be in the corner of the room, perhaps. Somebody would hold their ankles, and by going into the stability ball, they can recoil. So they can almost get a plyometric, concentric, eccentric, quick stretch. Those are very, very cool and very, very beneficial for individuals to do. Actually, my last slide is, I don't have it, is running-wise, I didn't put it in, we like running backwards. Running backwards is very, very good for your hip, for your hamstrings. You have about 20% higher EMG activity when you run backwards versus forward. It was interesting, yesterday I was at a Major League Baseball conference here in town, and the Yankees strength and conditioning coach was talking. And he said, hey, this year down in Tampa, we put in a hill, we're running backwards up a hill, trying to get these guys to have stronger hips, especially the pitchers and the fielders. And I'm sitting there, I'm going, wow, that's wonderful. It's interesting that it has crossed into another sport, baseball, which historically hasn't really pushed strength and conditioning. But I think that's a great way of activating your hips, activating your hamstrings. Your quads are even higher walking backwards or running backwards. So with that, Mel, probably to stay on time, maybe I'll stop there. Want to see if if there's a quick question or so while we change the computers.
Thanks, guys. A great job. Any questions from the audience? I can start off with one. Kevin, you said that time is not the issue. It's whether the patient's ready. But then you quote the study that says you go from 6 months to 9 months, you decrease the re-injury rate by 51%.
Right.
How are you kind of matching those two things together?
Yeah, I think a lot of these studies, I think as a consumer of research, I think we have to be careful. You know, because Dr. Nicholas's patients may be different than Dr. Andrew's patients. So when we start clumping ACL patients together, there's a wide variability. So for us, you know, and you know, maybe Dr. Kane can chime in as well. At the University of Alabama, if you're not going to go back to play for 9 months, we're in trouble. There's going to be some very angry coaches and so forth. So we expect you probably to be back in most sports at 6 to 7 months. Now, it's when you're ready, but in competitive athletes who are rehabbing every day, that probably speeds up the process. Your recreational people, I think when you clump them in, that's when, you know, going back to recreational sports like skiing or recreational soccer, you know, park district stuff, those are the ones I think if you delay maybe are better off. So I don't necessarily believe in that. Mm-hmm. I think when your knee is ready and psychologically you're ready, you go back. Now again, if you're going back at 3 months, I got a problem with that. But if you're going back at 6 months, 7 months, it depends on the sport too. I'm more apt to return somebody quicker to football than I am volleyball or basketball. Basketball is probably another month. That's probably a 7 month proposition as a rule of thumb. Okay. Do you agree? I mean, do you follow that mindset? Or?
I do. And honestly, the reality is, you say ligamentization takes 12 to 18 months. So we know that we're putting people back when they're really not ready as far as the biology is concerned. But your perturbation training is probably so important in those particular patients, particularly college athlete, that you're putting back before the graft is ready to take the full stress. But you're trying to accommodate for that by the physiologic adaptations to prevent the stress on the graft.
Could you maybe say something about the meniscus repair and would you like to do?
And so, yes, yeah, so just commenting on your meniscus repair, Kevin and I have been in agreement for this for a long time. I fully weight bear my meniscal repairs, unless I do a root repair where I think tension from compression on the root repair causes a problem. So then I'll protect those weight bearers. But any meniscus repair we do, we've let them full weight bear in extension, and we've found that the success rates are higher because you're getting compressive loads by converting those hoop stresses into compressive loads across the joint. So many people don't do that, and I think you're creating a tensile distraction load. I think you increase your failure rate. And I know Jim feels the same way. Lyle, you here? You want to comment on your approach to meniscal repairs and post op?
Yeah, I'm the same thing. The only ones I don't weight bear are root repairs or radial splits. So if it's a radial tear or another compression, just spread the two loose apart, I'll go that weight bear for 6 weeks with all the other compressions.
And Lyle, your experience on the meniscal repairs, radial tears in a white junction, are you doing those? Or do you have to be a kind of red tear?
These are primarily back to the capsule, so red yep. tears. Repair the outer surface and fill out the other surface.
Right. So you're doing a hybrid meniscectomy repair. Any other questions? Yes.
I read an article a while back in PD Magazine that Colorado first years surgeons are not opting for ACL repairs or reconstruction, and they are sticking to that surgery. So what's up with that?
Yeah, really. Yeah, what the heck is up with that? So those are, and again, if you're interested in that type of research, those are called COPERS versus non-COPERS. And the one, and she's not in Colorado, but they're probably adapting that philosophy, is again, Lynn Snyder-Mackler from Delaware. So they've written a couple papers where they've tried to identify people who have torn their ACL and do a battery of neuromuscular tests. And if they're proficient, they feel as though they can go on and try to deal with their knee without having an ACL reconstruction. And there's cases, you know, there's NFL players that have played, there's isolated cases, but again, I'd be interested in Dr. Nicholas, Dr. Kane's opinions on this. You know, we think if you tear your ACL, you're going back to high-level sports like skiing, cutting, pivoting, you need an ACL because we're worried about arthritic changes in the knee, and trashing your meniscus. Your meniscus is what preserves the longevity of your knee. And so, even though the research is somewhat compelling, this COPER versus non-COPER, I think it goes back to, again, who are we talking about? Are we talking about somebody that, you know, is doing hard cutting, hard pivoting, competitive sports? And by the way, as soon as you introduce an opponent, your rate of re-injury or injury goes up. Tons of European literatures have shown that if you do individual sports, your knees generally do better. Now, skiing is that one wild card because there's, you know, so much stress on your knee and fatigue and so forth. But the coping thing in Birmingham, we haven't been exactly on board on. But Lynn has written several papers. She's a close friend of mine. I think her research is interesting. But if my son or daughter tore their ACL, they would have an ACL reconstruction. Steve?
God forbid that would happen, but I agree with you. you know, I think you have to protect the knee, protect the meniscus. I thought you had some compelling information also on the chondral surface and the effect of bone bruises on chondral surface, because in the past that's not been washed out, and we're beginning to understand more about them. So I think that we're going to do more work on that in the future and see where we stand. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, that's a part of the talk. I'm not really good with time management. I'm getting worse by the minute. So I had some things in the handout. I'm going to send it to Mal, my PDF, and that way it will be in the handout. If you're interested in that, we had a consensus in Switzerland last year. And this paper was published in the British Journal of Sports Medicine, I want to say maybe February, March. Claire Arden is the lead author again out of Australia. And I mean, there were people from all over in this consensus, and we said we need a battery of tests that we can all do that we don't have, you know, sophisticated equipment. So it's a step lunge, it's balancing, it's a hop test. It's very practical tests that if you're in private practice and it's just you out there in, you know, Connecticut or New York, or you're in Birmingham, you can do it as well as somebody in a big, beautiful center with Biodexes and everything else. You know, you see, I have a lot of toys, obviously, and we like to do objective testing. But the average clinician
We've seen a few ACLs here. We need something we can all compare. So I would urge you to take a look at that paper. We're also working on a paper right now, Jay Ergang, myself, a couple other clinicians. We want to publish that in our literature, JOSPT. It's in the review process now, so stay tuned. But that information's in the handout. So I appreciate your question. I think we all need that criteria, the physician as well as the rehab staff. When are you actually ready? Because if you re-injure, as I tried to point out in the editorial, it's costly. It's costly to the insurance company. The insurance companies need to pay for objective testing if you're ready to return. So maybe you get 15 visits plus a test. Do you know what I mean? That needs to be what happens in the future. Because again, by the time they see Dr. Nicholas at 5 months and he makes that determination, it may not be based on objective testing, it may be. If we test at 5 months, we're eating the cost in rehab, which I'm okay with. I'm a concept guy, but I think we need to protect their knees long term. It's, to me, disheartening when somebody tears their opposite ACL, especially a young person. So that's my editorial for the day. Sorry.
So 30% are re-tearing, 21% are re-tearing the other side. Some of it could be because of proprioceptive adaptations. Some could be, and I think a lot of these ACLs that occur are non-contact ACLs on the first side, and those are the ones who are likely to tear the other side. And I think what that says is something about notch morphology rather than proprioception. And I've actually had three patients in my career who have actually done prophylactic notchplasties on. And it takes a lot to do it, but I had a pair of triplets, a set of triplets, and the mother. Mother had bilateral ACLs, two triplets had ACLs, two of the triplets had ACLs, the third one had one ACL, the two triplets had bilateral ACLs, third one had one ACL, actually prophylactically opened up her notch because she had a trefoil notch, and that was the first time I did it. Took a lot of kind of guts to do it. Then her cousin came to see me with the same family history of bilateral ACLs. I did that. Both those other knees did not tear their ACLs. It was anecdotal, but it made sense to me at the time.
Interesting. Good.
That's a great job. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you very much, Kevin.
Thank you.
Superb. Thank you so much. I appreciate
you.
Thank you.